Today's discussion is chapter 7 in our book, and this chapter is covering diesel fuel and then the low pressure part of the fuel system. So it's everything except for the injection pump and the injectors themselves is what includes that. So first we're going to start with the fuel, and the diesel fuel itself is classified according to its viscosity and its density. Those are the two things that they use to classify it. Commercially, you can buy diesel fuel as either number one diesel fuel or number two. Those are the two, really the main ones that we're gonna see. There is a number four diesel fuel. Number four diesel fuel is stove oil. It's for if you're heating your house with stove oil. So it's really thick, heavy. It is not classified or designed for mobile applications. It doesn't get taxed. If you were to use it in a mobile application and get caught on the road with it, you would get fined heavily. So, but it's really thick and it doesn't have all the properties. It's not really designed for your internal combustion engine. So I wouldn't use it. So number one's the least dense. So it's thin, its viscosity is gonna be low. And number four is gonna be the most dense and the most viscous, which means thick. Number one is a winter blend fuel. It's designed to be used in the winter only. It doesn't have a lot of BTUs or energy per gallon. So if you were to use it in the summer, it'll burn really quickly. It's gonna burn really hot. Your engine will tend to overheat, and it just doesn't have any energy into it. So your fuel mileage is gonna go down. So you don't wanna be using it in the summertime. You wanna use it only in the wintertime.
Part of that is people sort of don't freeze or it's yellow.
Its purpose of number one being low viscous is so it doesn't gel up. And we're going to be talking about gelling and all that, what it means. And so it's so it doesn't gel. So it flows. We want it to be able to flow in the winter. And number two is a summer blend. It's a thicker, more viscous, heavier body, and it has more energy. So in the summertime, it works well and it gives good fuel economy. And then again, number four is our stove oil. The fourth kind of fuel that we're going to be looking at is biodiesel. We'll talk a little bit about biodiesel. It's either some kind of fat-based, either from vegetables or some sort of animal source. Looking at hydrocarbons, there's a lot of hydrocarbons out there. Diesel fuel is a very complex hydrocarbon. So you got methane. You can see it's a real thin, volatile stuff, floats away real fast. Octane is more like what we'd see in gasoline. And then this word is spelled wrong, but I can't figure out how to correct it in this PowerPoint. But this should say cetane. So we're going to be seeing the word cetane a lot here. So this is cetane. So cetane or diesel fuel hydrocarbons, you can see is a very long, complicated chain. There's a lot of energy there, and it's more dense. It has a lot more density, and it has a lot more heat per unit. And they call it BTU, British Thermal Units, is BTU. So just like gasoline, it's distilled in a refinery. It's just a very large tower. The fuel is poured in the bottom. It's heated up. As it heats up, it's going to travel up until it gets to a point where it goes from a vapor to a liquid. And at that point, we actually draw it off. So there are chambers within this tower. And it's going to vaporize. When it turns to a vapor, we draw it off as whatever type of fuel it is. And you can see diesel fuel is way down here. Gasoline, lighter fuels, natural gas, lighter stuff's all at the top. So down here, residual fuel. So we're right above residual fuel. And asphalt is just like the heavy tar substance that's at the bottom. So you can see we're pretty far down. It's a pretty thick material, fluid that's coming out there. So you can go online and they have descriptions on how all this stuff takes place, and so I don't want to spend a lot of time here. So diesel fuel is classified by cetane rating. So gasoline is done with its octane rating. Diesel fuel is done by cetane rating. So it's a very different way of measuring it. It's the measure of the ignition quality of fuel and refers to its ignitability under compression. And a high cetane rating means fast ignition. Low cetane rating means slow ignition. So it's the opposite of octane, and we're going to see a little slide that shows how those two are designed on a chart. And you'll see that they're opposites of each other. cetane rating, this number. For fuel economy and power, the thicker the fuel, the more fuel economy you're going to get. So we talked about having a number one, a number two, and a number four. There is other numbers out there, and the local fuel guy, oil guy that I use for Schaefer Oil has talked to me about getting number six bunker fuel. And number six bunker fuel is what they would use in ocean-going vehicles. Number six would be a really thick, heavy fuel. If you get that in the middle of summer when it's hot, it'll actually flow through your system pretty well, and your fuel economy will go way up. Thicker it is, the better fuel economy you get. And because there are no regulation organizations that actually check fuel, you don't really know what you're getting. So we're going to show you how you can check your fuel to see kind of what you have. But there's, just like gasoline, there's no regulatory body. They have rules, they have state requirements, they have federal requirements, but nobody actually goes around and pulls samples and says, oh, we're going to fine you because you don't meet it. So every once in a while you can get number six bunker fuel, but you just don't know what you get. The important thing is the more energy, the thicker the fuel. So regulations, the EPA actually regulates diesel fuel like everything else. They're controlling sulfur content. This is a huge thing that they're controlling. The cetane rating, they're supposed to have certain numbers. When you read it on the service station panel, it should match what you're getting. So they say what you're supposed to have, but who knows what you're getting. And the last thing here is this aromatic content, and that is that thick body that gives you that energy, but that complex hydrocarbon that's an aromatic content is also very difficult to get it to burn. And that's part of why we have a lot of emissions, is if we get too concentrated of this aromatic thick hydrocarbons, it'll actually goes out as an emission because we can't burn it. So those are the three things that the EPA is focused on pretty heavily. So here's our little chart. Over here is octane rating. This is our gasoline. We go into a service station, we look at the number, and we got 87, 89. So octane rating, as the number goes up, the fuel becomes more stable. And it burns, it controls better, and so it's slower burning and more controlled. In the diesel side, we use cetane rating, and as the number comes down, we have a shorter ignition time. This would be like number one diesel fuel, and this would be closer to number two, number six, would be up the chart this way. So longer, thicker, heavier fuel.
So 30 is better?
Not necessarily better, because it's going to burn so slow that it just goes out of smoke.
The chart is opposite from gas.
It's the opposite.
The higher the number on gas, right, the better the burn.
Correct.
The higher the number on diesel, the better.
Correct.
Even though it's upside.
There's a point. I mean, obviously here we have red. There's a problem when you get up in the 100. When you get down here below 80, it has a problem. So there's an optimum number that's down in here.
100 octane do that?
Because it would be so slow burning that it wouldn't burn very well. So, I don't even know if they have 100%.
Have you ever seen 100 octane? They use it more in really high compression, like race cars and that type of thing.
Okay. So, usually these two charts are together, so this funnel comes down and the funnel goes back again. But anyway. But just realize that they're totally different numbers. The numbers go higher when I get better here, and the numbers are going to go.
Like my sister.
They actually go lower as we go. So we want fuel that's not super short. We don't want to burn really fast, but we don't want to burn too slow. So we're going to be up in this area here is where we're trying to be. And the lower the number, the thicker it is, the more energy you're going to have. So we actually want lower numbers to get more energy. And here we want higher numbers to get more stability in our fuel.
In my sister's car on the gas cap, it says only 90 octane or above.
She has to have a high compression engine, so. So important thing is you buy clean fuel. When you actually look at fuel, pull it out, put it into a container. The first one is biofuel, and they have some colors. This is commonly what we'd see with dyed fuel. But diesel itself, when you actually put it in a jar and it doesn't have any dye in it, in the winter, number one, is not quite clear, but it's very, very light. Slight greenish look to it, but it's very light yellow. In the summer, you get number two, some good quality number two, and it'll actually get somewhat dark. Have a like an iced tea kind of color to it. So it'll start getting a dark amber color. And then the red dye, there's no difference between number one dyed fuel and number one non-dyed fuel. The fuel itself is exactly identical. The only difference between dyed fuel and undyed fuel is whether you pay taxes or not. So the dye is just an additive to check to see if you are pulling your weight when it comes to road taxes. Diesel fuel is measured by its specific gravity. The lower the specific gravity, the less energy it has. And so right here on the table, we have an instrument. And this is what we use to measure specific gravity. It's a temperature compensated specific gravity tester. And on the top is a row of bunch of numbers. So you just draw a sample of fuel. Take this thing and drop it in. And it has to float. So you have to have something thin enough, tall enough that it actually can float. And then you're going to be looking at what number is it on there. And this particular one, I think, was at 37. So the number comes out to 37. And that's the specific gravity. So what I'd like to find is a chart that kind of shows what the specific gravity number kind of translates into. That way you could actually sample what you have. The only way of knowing whether you have number one, number two, number six, or whatever you have, really is to measure the specific gravity. That's the only way you'll ever know. So if you really want to pay attention to what you have and what kind of fuel you're getting, and it's not really the quality as much as what weight you have, so you're not getting too thin or too thick, really is to have one of these little tools. And I was given that tool, so I don't know what it costs. I think you can get them pretty regularly. It's not an uncommon tool. They use it for winemaking and alcohol testing, and they use it for a lot of things. And so I don't think it's that hard to get. It's just, I don't know what it costs. So that's one way that we're going to measure. I'm going to put the cap back on so this doesn't get knocked over. So you guys can play with this later. It'd be interesting to pull some fuel out of some of the tanks that you have that's coming from other people and kind of check them and see how close they are to this. This container has half fuel that's been in that container for 2 years. Part of it came out of our little container over there. And so I have no idea what really its source is and what time of year it came in. So it'd be interesting to pull some out of your vehicles and check them to see what they are. So that's the first thing that's going to check, or how fuel is actually rated. That's by its specific gravity. That's a very common, the most important thing. Second thing is going to be flash point. And the flash point is at what point does it actually ignite? And so diesel fuel is somewhere between 100 and 125 degrees Fahrenheit. You take a container of diesel fuel, you strike a match, you drop it in there, it goes out. Gasoline is around minus 45. You strike a match, got a can of gas, you drop it in, it ignites, and it really doesn't ignite. If you can get the match to hit the fuel, it'll go out. But usually as it travels through, the vapor starts to form on top of the surface, and that vapor will ignite. And that's really what you're igniting. And that's true with diesel. You have to ignite the vapor, not the liquid. And that's why when I drop a match into diesel, it goes out. It's because there's no vapor there to ignite. It takes a lot of temperature. So if you take a pan of diesel and you want it to ignite, you take a piece of paper, wad it up, stick it in the fuel so the paper's sticking up out of there, and then light the paper on fire. And you just hold your match to the paper and it'll ignite if it's got fuel on it. If it doesn't have fuel, it'll ignite. And the paper will burn until it gets down to the point where the fuel is actually wicked up, and then it slows down. And it'll sit there and it'll burn real low. And what it'll do is actually vaporize the fuel around the paper. So you watch it, it'll burn, it'll get a little bit bigger, and then you'll see a couple of blue flickers, and pretty soon it goes, and it actually will just travel across. But it has to boil the fuel and get the fuel hot enough to create vapors. And it may take up to a minute before it actually ignites the fuel. So you have to have some sort of consistent heat source on the top of the fuel to vaporize it before it will actually take place. So it's pretty safe as far as, you know, working around it. It doesn't explode or have a, you know, violent flames, but it's really high flash point. The next thing that we're going to be using to kind of measure it is this auto ignition temperature. And it's the temperature that fuel ignites when heated. And for diesel fuel, when you heat it where it will auto ignite, is pretty high, 360 to 400 degrees Fahrenheit. That's a pretty high temperature. So that stuff's got to be hot, vaporized before it'll ignite. And that's why, again, it's very safe. You get an accident, you're not going to see this big fireball go up. Pretty nice. Volatility, how easily it converts into a vapor. And diesel fuel boils between 270 and 630 degrees Fahrenheit. So if I take it, pour it on the asphalt outside in the middle of summer, asphalt, you know, may get up above these temperatures, but for the most part, unless it's really super hot, it just kind of sits there. So you don't actually see, it doesn't vaporize very fast.
Why is the so wide of a boiling range? Are we dealing with that because of the type of, there's different types of diesel fuel, or is that because of atmosphere pressure?
It is mainly because of the differences in the types. And the book kind of goes a little more in depth in this particular category, but I didn't just go here just because it's not something that you can control. And the idea really is just, I just want you to be aware it doesn't vaporize very fast. And that's why diesel engines don't have a vapor canister. They don't take it out of the tank and run it to a canister because it just doesn't vaporize.
So when they go to refine it, that's why usually diesel is one of the first things they do.
It's just point. Because it's real thick and so it's real hot. So at what point when you cool it off, does it vaporize, turn into a liquid? It goes to a liquid pretty quick. So I'm more concerned rather than what fuels do that. I mean, it is the type of fuels. It's just important to know it doesn't have much for vapor. So you can't use it in the winter and expect it's going to vaporize very well.
It would be an obvious correlation between the winter mix. Diesel fuel is going to boil much sooner than the summer mix.
Number four, number six bunker fuel, number one. So yeah, the type of fuel is going to make a big difference in it. So knowing that this thing has a real high and you have expectations that it's going to be high, if you were to mix it with some other type of alcohol or some kind of gasoline, you should understand, yes, it's going to drop it. If you don't understand that somebody mixed it and you didn't know about it, you're expecting it to be high, and all of a sudden you drop a match to some diesel fuel and it ignites on you, it would kind of catch you by surprise. So you got to be careful about mixing fuels. So mixing the fuel can lower that flash point, its volatility, and it could react different. The other thing is, and when we talk about mixing it, we're usually doing some kind of alcohol or some kind of gasoline. That's what I'm targeting here. And so if I put gasoline in there, gasoline has no lubricity to it. It's going to lower its lubricity. You're going to see more damage in the fuel system. And certain alcohols are going to actually corrode the metal. Since the diesel fuel actually protects all the metal, provides lubricity, if we put alcohol or gasoline in here, we're going to see these other issues come up. So you want to be very careful about that. Here's a little test stand, and they're using, that's that hydrometer that you see. So here's the hydrometer, here's the number. It's hydroscopic, which means it attracts water, it becomes cloudy and darkens when contaminated with water. So we're going to be looking at a container on the table here. that has water in it. So this container here. So the top part of this is fuel and the bottom of this is water. And we're going to talk more about this, but this used to be red. So this last year or so, it's really starting to get dark. And it's fairly well sealed with this lid on it. But you can see when it mixes with the water, over time it's going to start darkening and get dark. Over the weekend, I had one of those tow behind air compressors, large air compressors, and I took my fuel cap off last week and it was all rusted. And I looked down in the tank and you can tell I started to drain the tank and I'm getting this color material coming off the bottom of the tank. It's just kind of wedged into this machine pretty hard, but I thought, we just need to pull it out. I've got the time, I don't really have the time, but I need to take the time to pull the tank. So I pulled the tank out and we drained it. And the bottom of the tank had about a half of an inch of this nasty dark fuel and water and was kind of running around. I found a stick in there that somebody was using to check the fuel level, and then they dropped it in there, so it was probably about this long, big flat stick. And I found a wire about this long that somebody must have been measuring, and it dropped in, and then it sat in this water mixture at the bottom, and that wire was almost completely rusted through and gone. So it was probably half of it was rusted away because it sat in that water.
Is that why some combines or whatever have like water separators on the
All diesel fuel systems will have some sort of water separator. Most diesel engine diesel fuel tanks have some kind of drain on the fuel tank to drain that water and contaminant away. Water is really bad, and we're going to talk about it more about what it does. But this dark fuel, I drained everything into a clean white 5-gallon buckets, and one bucket was off the bottom of the tank and one was more of the higher level stuff. So one, you can see it's red, and the other one, the whole bottom is, it looks like this, it's black.
So does it separate like kind of like with water or oil? Does the water sink to the bottom first?
Water will sink to the bottom in diesel fuel, but water and diesel fuel mixes pretty readily. So we're going to talk about that shortly too. But water, if you take water and mix it with diesel and shake it up, if I put it in that container, shook it up, put it on the table, it would take days before it would separate. Gasoline, I put it in there, I shake it up. We got that little alcohol tester. You shake it up, put it on the table. In a matter of 10 seconds, the water drops to the bottom. Water and gasoline separate like that. Water and diesel emulsifies. It mixes together. So we have special filters that actually separate that water out. We'll be talking about that when we talk about filters. So yes, it does. And yes, it collects at the bottom, but it's a slow process. So, and we'll drain it off. So here's our hydrometer. API index is 37, which is interesting because that's what ours is. So temperature compensated API corresponds to closely to the grade of fuel. So what I'm looking for is a chart that says what number matches what grade. So I'd like to find a chart like that so I could actually utilize the thing more. But ours, if you go read it, it's at 37. So I don't know if that's number one or number two. Flash point obviously is higher, so biodiesel is pretty high. Bunker fuel, that would be number six fuel. Here's some diesel fuel. Jet fuel is in between diesel fuel and gasoline. And you can see gasoline is way down here. Below zero, it vaporizes pretty quick. So you want to be careful. Even if somebody was to put jet fuel, which is similar to diesel fuel, if you put jet fuel into a machine versus diesel fuel, it's going to react and you're going to have different responses from it. So knowing what fuel they put in there is going to be important. And that's where that hydrometer would come in. Take it, put it in there. You would know between these two or this one what was in there.
When I was working at Tom's Cycle, they have a pressure washer that they use jet fuel in. And so I don't remember if it's a, well, obviously you can't put jet fuel in a gasoline engine, but presuming that it was a diesel engine, they use jet fuel in their pressure washer instead of
instead of diesel fuel or just instead of kerosene?
Well, the engine itself, I don't know if it was diesel or whatever. I just know that they had me fill it and they had the jet fuel.
Where did they get the jet fuel from?
I don't know, probably from the airport maybe, but I don't know where they get it.
Why someone would use jet fuel, because it's not readily available. It's not something I'm just going to go down to a service station and get. And so being able to have access to an airport to get it, yes, we do have an airport here. I don't know why they would have put jet fuel in it. So usually pressure washers, if it's a hot water washer, is using diesel fuel or kerosene. Kerosene is more like a winter fuel.
But he was saying put the jet, he had a separate container that had jet fuel in it. So.
And it could be, that's what it is, but it's a thicker fuel, but it's not as thick and heavy as diesel fuel. And I would imagine if I was to use jet fuel in a pressure, like a high hot water washer or what we would call a steam cleaner, then a jet fuel would burn cleaner and it wouldn't soot up as much. The problem might be, you gotta be careful, if I'm used to running diesel fuel, it's adjusted for diesel fuel and I'm running jet fuel, the hot water washer could overheat. So you can actually cause damage. So you want to be careful about just switching. You better kind of understand what you're doing before you start swapping fuels, because the temperature it's going to produce is going to be faster. So, and they may know that this is what they're using. They may have adjusted the temperature or done something. So some of the newer pressure washers have temperature sensors on there, and it kind of restricts the fuel when it gets to a certain temperature, kind of shuts the fuel off. Older ones that are just burning away can overheat, so just be careful about that. Diesel fuel ignition properties. So this is a chart that's in your book. They talk about flammability, auto ignition, flash points, and so you just got the ranges that are in there, kind of a comparison between gasoline and diesel. Gasoline and diesel are very, very different on these three characteristics. So we're going to react different. So one of the major differences, the engines are very similar, but the fuel is very different. So when you go to a service station, if it has diesel fuel, you'll notice that around the diesel fuel pump, it's going to be really dirty. And why is it dirty?
Because it collects water.
No, not because it collects water. Why will I expect to see a lot more grime around a diesel fuel pump in a service station than around the gas ones?
Because diesel fuel does not vaporize as fast as gasoline, so it sticks, and not any dust and air just blows and sticks over gasoline, it drops and vaporizes.
So you look, it's kind of looks like there's, you know, like a liquid oily residue, and that really is just the diesel fuel. Like you said, if it doesn't vaporize, somebody spills, it stays there. Gasoline, they spill as much gasoline as you see on the ground for the diesel. The problem is the gasoline within minutes is gone, and diesel, it may take days. So then they throw floor dry on it, and that just kind of spreads and just makes a bigger mess and it's nasty. And so some service stations, just to keep it so they don't have to be dirty, just don't offer diesel fuel. So they may not have a tank for it, and then they don't have to be as oily, so they just
go to a separate pump.
Off to one side somewhere, so that's true. So they look dirty because of the fact that they don't vaporize. So two things about diesel fuel. There's pour point and cloud point. And in diesel fuel, there's a lot of paraffin wax. It's an actual physical wax that's in there. It's kind of burns. It gives a lot of energy, a lot of BTU in this wax. And the temperature that the wax molecules actually crystallize or look cloudy is the cloud point. So we call it cloud because when it starts to crystallize, if it was in a container, it would start to look cloudy. And so we call it the cloud point. The point at which it thickens and doesn't pour is the pour point. So you get to a point where it actually just doesn't come out. The wax crystals completely form into wax, and it'll look like a snowflake. You put your finger in and pull it out, it'll look like a snowflake, but if you did it on your finger, the heat from your finger would melt and it'd turn back to a liquid. But it looks just like snowflakes if you look it into a container. We call it gelling. That's kind of what we refer to it as, but it's actually the paraffin wax. The wax is actually crystallizing and solidifies. So we're going to call it gelling. So my vehicle gelled up. If you have a vehicle and it has number 2 diesel fuel in it, it's winter time, it's 2 degrees below zero, and all of your fuel gels up, it's not going to hurt you unless you try to start it. And the problem is, if you try to start it, all those wax crystals are traveling down your fuel system. The finest point in your fuel system is going to be your filter. Hits the filter, the wax crystals can't go through the filter, they build up, and there's an excess amount of wax crystals in there, and it seals off the fuel filter, and you starve for fuel. So the engine doesn't start. The guy's driving down the road, he filled up down in Southern California, he's got 200 gallon tanks, 250 gallon tanks, he heads north, he hits a winter storm, he pulls in, shuts his truck off for the night, jumps up in the morning, starts it up, and vroom, he doesn't get very far. So that happens, people that travel huge distances with big tanks. Or you simply forget, you got number 2 fuel in there, it's late fall, we get an early freeze, and you start something up, and it just doesn't start. If you put some kind of liquid heat or something in the system, it still won't start. If you put the liquid system in there, liquid stuff, and run it and mix it with your fuel, you're fine. But the secret is you have to have it running. If you don't have it running and you don't mix it to the system, you're done. So if you have a system and you decided to try to stop it, it dies because it gelled, all this wax is going to be in the filter. You have to do 2 things. One, you have to get the system warm. So you really almost have to pull it into a warm building, get some heat in, or you have to try to put heat underneath the machine, which is rather difficult in cold weather, and you got to get the whole system to get warm. And when it gets warm, the wax will go back to a liquid. Then you can actually flush it. You can actually get it to go through. And you still need to replace that filter, because the filter is going to have an excess amount of wax in it, and it, when it liquefies, it's all full of paraffin wax. So you could try to heat it up really hot, try to drain it really well, but it just doesn't make sense. Just replace the fuel filters. Get it warm, buy filters, put them in, get rid of the water, whatever else is in there, replace the filters, bleed the system, and then it eventually will start. So that's what happens if you don't. If you just leave it alone, it'll crystallize in the summer day, hot day, it'll liquefy, and the concentration is correct and it won't do anything to you. Number 2 diesel fuel starts to cloud up at 40 degrees. 40 degrees is pretty warm. And so if you have some good solid number 2 diesel fuel, you know, we get 40 degrees in the fall pretty early. So you can have a problem pretty quick. So all places around the country tend to watch the weather, your fuel supplier, and they'll start blending it and they'll change that. So low end design temperature is your fuel distributor. They look and say, okay, what's the low end temperature for October? They look at the average, they look at, you know, what we normally see, and okay, the lowest temperatures we ever get in Walla Walla in October might be 40 degrees. So anticipating that people tend to store their fuel, kind of looking at what you do, they will start blending the fuel with number 1 and number 2 so that we lower this from 40 degrees down into lower temperature. And so this low-end design is the manufacturers or the fuel distributor people blending or adding an additive in there so that when you get out on the road, you don't have that problem. And there are companies here, Blue Mountain Fuel, that, you know, you would guarantee, hey, we guarantee you that you will never die, you will never gel up. And every once in a while we'll have one of those super early crazy cold snaps that we have on 1st of October that hits 16 degrees, and once or twice they get bit because all of a sudden all these trucks will just freeze up and they got to go out and try to get them all going again. So most regions are going to adjust for that. The only place that bites you is if you buy your fuel someplace down south and then try to travel up north. That's where you start to get in trouble. But the average person buys this fuel from a service station. If you're using your vehicle very much, it's going to be used up and your system shouldn't gel up. If you don't use your vehicle very often, I've been using my pickup in the summer and it's been sitting all of a sudden in December, I'm like, you know, I'm anticipating I'm gonna be using my pickup, then I can buy an additive, I can pour it in my tank, and on a warm day, I'd want to pour it in my tank, start it up, run it for 10 minutes or so, and get it to circulate, and then I'll be fine. So if I have farm equipment that sits around, I use it only in the summer, but I want to do some maintenance on it in the winter, and I want to try to get it in my shop, I'm either going to pick a warm day to get it in my shop, or I'm going to go mix something in the tank and actually make it to where it'll start when it's cold. So I have to anticipate that experience. If you're working at a golf course and you have a bunch of equipment in your warehouse and you're going to be doing winter maintenance over the winter, you would want to look at on a warm day if in the next couple of weeks the temperature is going to drop and I anticipate we're going to be bringing these three fairway mowers in, I might want to go treat those tanks, run them for 10 minutes so that when that day comes I can get them into my shop. So you just need to think ahead with the situation if the fuel that you're using has not been treated for that season. Because they're only anticipating about a month out, kind of what's happening this month, and they try to adjust for that. Lubricity, another thing that we're going to be looking at in fuel. Diesel fuel relies on the fuel itself to lubricate the entire fuel system. The fuel injection pump, it has a seal at both ends, but everything inside is lubricated by the diesel fuel. The injection nozzles are lubricated by the fuel itself. And so it relies on it. It has to be a good quality fuel to be able to do that. In the old days, they had sulfur in there, and sulfur was a great lubricant, but with our new emission standards and all these after-treatment systems, sulfur is gone. For the most part, it's gone. It's down to less than 10% sulfur. There's a number, might even be less than that. And so sulfur has been taken away, so our lubricity of our fuels have gone down. And so we got to make sure that we don't have other bad stuff in there that's going to actually cause any less lubrication. Water would be an example of something that's going to have less lubrication. Gasoline would be something that would be less lubrication. So it's critical that our fuel is good quality and that the lubricity is correct. Ultra-low diesel fuel. In 2007, they came out with ultra-low diesel fuel, and that was 15. Someone think it's 0.15. So in your book, it has a number. So I think it's 15 something. Parts per million, maybe it's 15 parts per million. And in 2011, we went to super low diesel fuel, and now it's down to, I think it's 10 parts per million. So it's went from 15 to 10. Now we're at super ultra low diesel fuel. So it's even less. If you were to run something that wasn't low sulfur in the new equipment with after treatment systems, your catalytic material, so whatever they're using for filtration or catalyst, it will react with it and screw it up. So you do not want to be using anything but ultra or super ultra fuel in anything 2007 and newer. So it's important. And it's becoming more difficult to buy it so that we don't get cross-contamination. It's pretty hard to even buy anything that's not super old, low sulfur. Aromatic content, this is another thing that you'll be seeing, and that is that long chain, the hydrocarbon. Aromatic chains and diesel fuel is very difficult to burn. It's actually what gives the diesel fuel some of that odor that we smell. And that aromatic chains don't burn very well, and since they don't burn very well, they end up leaving the tailpipe and become an emission. And so to reduce emissions, they're reducing the amount of aromatic content. That aromatic content is the thicker fuel. That's what actually gives us a lot of energy. So throwing it out completely is not a good thing. So we're trying to regulate that, put some in, but not get very much. Viscosity of the fuel, if it gets too thin, because we have ultra low sulfur fuel, by getting too thin a fuel, I'm running number one fuel in the summertime, too thin, low viscosity, you're going to start seeing a lot of leakage around fuel components. The fuel itself is the seal. When we start taking a diesel fuel pump apart, it's just metal to metal. The only thing that seals it is the fuel itself. If you get too thin a fuel, then it's actually going to start wearing and you're going to have damage. So we want to be careful about running the wrong viscosity of fuel in your fuel system. And this is what it looks like around a service station. It's hard to see here, but it's just a lot of oil. A lot of times you'll see floor dry because it's been slippery. You walk out there and it gets on your shoes, you get in your car, now I have diesel prints on my car. So it kind of is a problem for a lot of service stations. So and some of them just don't address it, so it actually becomes a safety hazard because you can slip on it and it gets on your shoes. Customers aren't very happy, especially if they don't have a diesel and they get it in their car. So want to be careful about that. Cloud point, pour point. So cloud point is just when the crystals begin to form, and pour point is lower than that, and that's actually when it stops moving. In 2011 is when they went to the super ultra, so that's parts per million. So 15 parts per million was in 2007, and then in 2011 it dropped from 15 down to 10 parts per million. That's a pretty small amount of sulfur in your fuel. Biofuel is most biofuels are going to come from some kind of seed or some kind of grains. That's just the most common. Corn is a common biofuel product. Some of the problems with corn is you have to grow the corn. It takes a lot of energy to grow corn, and then you got to convert the corn into diesel fuel. So it's kind of expensive to kind of do that whole process. And it's taking these grains out of the food chain and putting it into diesel fuel. So now the price of food goes up, and they keep talking about world hunger and we're not producing enough food, and then we're taking food to make diesel fuel. And so there's a lot of debate. We're not going to get into the debate, but a lot of debate out there. So there's a lot of other options out there. There's lots of different grains that they can use. They can actually use wood alcohols and wood fuels to kind of convert. So there's a lot of things. In Boardman, which is not very far from here, an hour from here, there's a plant, and there's a lot of those poplar trees, huge poplar tree farms, that they're taking, they were converting it into paper and other products like that. Then they were taking the tree and they were making furniture out of it. So they were growing the tree and then cutting it for firewood, and the top 10 foot of the tree and all the small branches and all the leaves, they were just shredding it, blowing it back on the ground and replanting. Well, that fuel plant over there, they were taking that top and all that waste product, chopping it up, grinding it, turning it into biofuels. So there's a plant in Boardman that actually takes all that waste product from the tree farm, converts it into biofuels. They also take corn stalks and wheat stubble. So instead of taking the seed, which is taking it out of our food chain, they're taking the byproduct, the stubble, the stalk, in the waste part of the tree, converting that into fuels, different kinds of fuels. And so part of that is the diesel fuel. So they're trying to come up with alternatives that aren't taking it from the seed part in the food chain. So pure oils themselves, when they go to biofuel, the pure oil itself is too thick. So there's other processes that they go through that changes it, makes it more usable. And this big long word, transesterification, is a process that removes the glycerin. The glycerin is what makes it thick. They remove the glycerin, they add an alcohol. Your book has a whole page or two that goes into that whole process. Just know that there's a process. They don't just take the pure oil and actually put it in the tank. And then they get into this biodiesel. So if you look on your book on page 123, then it's like a full page of all the advantages of biofuels. And there are lots of advantages to biofuels. When you read that list, you think, boy, that's good stuff. We want to use it. And then you turn the page to page 124, and then there's an equally long list, and it's long, and I'm not going to type all that out. And so there's an equally long list of problems with diesel biofuels that when you read the two lists, I mean, you can see why it's not the common thing that's out there. But there are a lot of advantages. There's a lot of the emissions and stuff that comes from diesel fuel that we can eliminate by using biofuel. But it is unstable in some cases, and it does do a lot of bad things. So I want you to go look at those two lists. Make sure you read through them and be aware. Somebody's going to ask you whether they can use biodiesel. Can I just put vegetable oil in my car? Can I buy biofuel and put it in my pickup? So there's lots of people that are experimenting with different things. Just make sure you do the research before you do it, because you need to anticipate, if I'm going to switch from regular fuel to biofuels, there's going to be some natural reactions that take place that are going to be a problem. How often you change your oils is going to be different. So you need to do all the research before you just jump into biofuels. So read those lists. Straight vegetable oil. If you were to run straight vegetable oil, go to McDonald's, go to any of these fast food places and get their oils and just run them through your car. Straight vegetable oil leads to coking. Coking is when oil just kind of burns and solidifies. It's a buildup of carbon on the injector tips, reduces flow, you have irregular nozzle patterns. And this short time is like in 10,000 miles, it'll actually do some damage. So you don't want to just decide, I heard somebody did this, I'm going to go for it. Make sure you do the research. The other problem is in the engine oil. So biofuel, just because of its nature and how it burns, it doesn't vaporize very well. Its vaporization point, as we've seen back and further, was a lot higher. When it gets into the combustion chamber, it likes to stick to things instead of vaporizing. It sticks to the cylinder walls. Our rings do a great job of scraping it, doing their job, scrapes it, puts it in the oil. And then when it gets in the oil, instead of getting warm, vaporizing and sucking it out our crankcase ventilation system and burning again or putting it out in the atmosphere, it actually stays in the oil, collects other material, thickens the oil, dilutes the oil, because there's only so much detergent in the oil, and so it uses up all the detergent and then it just goes bad.
Yeah, it's
not particulate matter, it's just, it's not oil, and anything that's not oil is a contaminant. And so if you get biofuel in the oil, the detergents are designed to clean it. So the detergent reaches out, grabs it, and cleans it. So it's like, I'm going to throw you a ball, and then I throw you another ball, and I throw you another ball. Pretty soon you get to a point, you're like, I can only hold so many balls, right? And after that, what happens when I keep throwing balls at you? It's like me telling you too many things when I have a lecture. Pretty soon you just fall asleep and it just keeps going over your head. You know, I keep throwing stuff at you. Pretty soon you're like, I'm done. Well, that's what happens with the detergent in my oil. It only holds so much. And with biofuels, we get so much trash into the oil, it dilutes it. The detergent's like, I'm full. And if I don't change the oil and put new detergent in there, it doesn't work. So it's going to start getting black, it's going to start caking. The other material, sludge and acids and all the other stuff that's in there, it's going to start covering, thickens the oil, and you're going to have problems. So biodiesel, you have to change the oil more often. And partly because it doesn't vaporize. So It's just part of that research that you find. This is a picture that kind of shows the process that one form of biodiesel is formed, and it's not a simple process. And it goes through this whole chain of events to get to the point where you can put it in your truck. And there are different kinds of processes that you can make biodiesel. This is one manufacturer's way of making biofuel from vegetable oil. And it takes a lot of energy to heat something up. Then you have to separate it. You got to process it. So it just takes a lot of energy. So one of the disadvantages of diesel fuel is to make it. It takes a lot of energy to make it so that we can have something that gives us energy. So it costs a lot of money to make something, which makes it more expensive than standard diesel fuel coming out of the ground. So it's not simple. Biodiesel promotes fuel dilution, so we talked about that already. Fuel dilution of the oil, and much more extent than petroleum, because petroleum has a lower vapor point. So even if it gets into the oil, it can actually get hot enough to vaporize, suck it out, and not contaminate the fuel. So they also interfere with the action of ZDP. I already forgot what ZDP is, so it's products and additives that's in your oil. So it tells you in your book what ZDP stands for. But it's, the point is, it actually is just shortens the life of your oil. Synthetic diesel fuel, there is a way of making synthetic diesel fuel, and they go from a gas to a liquid. And there's this process, this is a name, but it's very expensive, it's not economical. They are always working on new ways of producing fuel other than pulling it out of the ground. So this is using gases, it's also using gases from coals, using a lot of different things. So always constant research, there will be changes expected. So keeping up, you know, getting the magazines that kind of talk about, the Diesel Progress magazine, keeping up what's changing, what's happening, it's going to be changing very quickly. And it's been changing very quickly. It'll continue to change quickly. This is a world that you're not going to just expect that whatever you learn in this class will be good for 20 years. What you learn in this class can be good for maybe 4 years. And after that, there's going to be a dramatic change in what happens in this world. So what I learned when I was in college was good for about 15, almost 20 years. What's happened the last 5 years is like revolutionarily changed the whole diesel world. So they're not even remotely close. So it's today you have to really be on top of what's changing. You've got to be proactive about keeping up with the changes in the diesel fuel and all of the different stuff. All the emission standards and all different segments is changing it. So you have to be reading magazines and stuff. Otherwise, you're going to be outdated pretty quick. One of the things that you can do is you can do additives. You can put additives in your fuel to help compensate for all these problems that you're having. But additives are not regulated. Yes, you're supposed to send them in and they're supposed to go through some testing processes, see if they're good, but not all additives are really tested. There's a lot of stuff out there that just says, hey, yeah, we do this job. So those of you that were at the EETC conference last year with Stabil, Stabil was talking about all the different kind of stabilizer products. So you go in there and you got this potpourri list of stuff that's there. And a lot of them claim to have it, but there's no facts that back them up. And Stabil had, you know, they tried to have facts. We have this testing process that was, you know, mandated by somebody else, outside testers, what we have really works. There's a lot of products when you walk into any store, and it's just like, whew, what do I buy? Well, the reality is just like engine oil. You buy a good engine oil, you're fine. Use the oil, don't add anything. Buy good fuel, don't add anything. And so additives are a buyer beware situation. Unless you really, really, really know I don't know how you're going to really know. I mean, unless you get all the way to the manufacturer level and actually see the documentation and understand how it's documented, it's pretty hard. It is really tough to follow through and see who's lying to you, who's not. Because there are some very convincing con artists out there that, you know, they're the best. Even the fuel jobbers that come around and talk to me. I mean, most of them I trust them pretty well, but even then I have, and you know, are you just pulling the wool over my eyes, trying to make your product look good? Because their product is always the best, and the next guy's is the best. So you can't all be the best. You got to be good, but you may not be the best. So it's hard, really hard. So just buy good quality fuel, buy good quality oil. Don't buy Master Mechanic. You don't know what you're getting. So there's lots of additives out there. They're basically following these four categories. You have engine performance enhancers, something to keep it stable so it doesn't go bad so fast, some kind of fuel handling. I don't know what kind of examples there is. I think there's a chart that shows you that. And then some kind of contaminant control. These are the four kinds that are out there, the four categories. But in those four categories, there are lots of them out there. So buy good fuel. Here's the different additives and what they're trying to actually accomplish. So the stuff that you buy on your shelf has something. One of these things is what they're trying to target. So they have a little ad saying, hey, ours keeps it from creating bubbles in the system and it helps it flow through the pipes really well. Okay, well, if I buy good fuel, I don't need that. So anyway, there's lots of additives and lots of purposes for them. Requirements of low pressure fuel system. So again, like the main components, fuel tanks, some way of storing it. We're seeing a lot more plastic tanks than metal tanks. You cannot use a galvanized storage vessel at all when it comes to diesel fuel systems. So you rarely see it, but if you happen to have one, diesel and galvanized react and it will actually separate it. If you were to put a line, like if you put metal pipe, you got black pipe and then you got galvanized pipe, if for some reason you decided I wanted to use a galvanized, and probably the most common would be my storage container. So I got this tank, it's a metal tank, plastic tank, and then I have a pump, and the pump's going to be connected to a hose. So how do I get from the tank through the pump to the hose? So we're going to use a galvanized nipple and maybe a thing, and then we have a filter, and then it kind of comes out as another galvanized fitting, and then we hook the hose to it. And that's probably the most common place that we're going to see galvanized become an issue. So when you come out of that tank in a gas system, if you were to use galvanized fittings, it's fine, it's not going to rust. But in a diesel system, if I use galvanized fittings instead of a black pipe fitting, it's going to cause you a problem. As far as finding a storage can that's galvanized, pretty hard to do. So, but galvanized reacts with it. So just keep that in mind as you're playing with stuff. So that's store fuel tanks. Most diesel fuel tanks have some sort of drain. Some place there's going to be a low point and there's a drain to drain the water out. Because water in diesel fuel is really bad, as we'll talk about here shortly. So most of them have some sort of draining system, part of your service. Every couple of months you should drain it. In our area, we don't have a lot of rain, and so once a year you really should drain and crack it, get any water off the bottom. Fuel lines, usually low pressure, it's going to be some kind of fuel line. Make sure that wherever the fuel lines are, it can't get caught up and mechanically rubbed or smashed or damaged. Air leaks is probably one of the worst problems with a diesel fuel system. You get air in a gas system and it's not such a big deal, but in diesel, since air has no lubricating value and has no lubricity, and that's what we're using, it causes a lot of damage pretty fast. So we want to make sure that our fuel lines and our filters and everything are sealed and that we don't have air ingestion into them.
Can you get like aeration in the high pressure side, which causes cavitation?
I don't know that I've ever seen where it causes cavitation in the high pressure side. What it does do here is the fact that in the new fuel injectors, because the diesel cushions it, if we get air in there, that pintle, when it's being slammed with the electric solenoid, instead of slamming against the fuel, which kind of acts as a cushion, with air in there, it just, bam, smashes, and it actually damages the pintle. So they talk about the newer high-pressure injectors are just the fact that there's nothing, there's no lubrication, and there's nothing to cushion it, so it slams against it and damages it. So that's where the high pressure side comes into a problem. Air itself expands and contracts, and if you get air between your injection pump and your fuel injection nozzles, on a lot of systems, that will act as a shock absorber. An example would be Perkins. Perkins is notorious. If you run your machine out of fuel and you get air in the line, or you change your fuel filter and then you try to start it without bleeding the system, if it gets air between the injection pump and the nozzles, it won't run. You bleed number one and number two, get your vehicle to start, it'll run on two cylinders, and if you don't crack every single injector and get the air out of every single injector, it'll run on two cylinders for weeks and never purge the air out. Yes. So we bled every one of them and got the stuff out. Some systems, most Yanmar systems, there's enough leakage pass for cooling and lubrication that it'll actually purge the air through. You run out of fuel, you bleed it to the pump, start it up, it'll actually bleed through. But certain machines, certain brands, you got to bleed the air 100%. And what happens is the fuel pushes up, it expands. As soon as the pressure goes off, it pushes back. And once we get into the pumps, that'll make more sense why that takes place. So it'll lead to poor performance or control, how much you can control the fuel delivery. So it's important that you do not have air in the system. We're going to see, there's another slide that talks about, we'll get into air again. And this is that no cushion, so it slams up against there.
Are we going to take a break? We go to water and diesel? Do you want to split this up or make one big normal?
I think we're just going to keep pushing through. We could just stop it and then it would break it up. So, doesn't matter.
His stomach is growling. He's about to fall asleep. He's having a hard time paying attention when he's not passed
out. So this particular one, I left this slide in. I took out a bunch of slides to make this a little bit shorter, so there's more slides in your textbook. I left this one in because this is a good example of what's coming. The systems used to be pretty simple, but this one, we're sucking the fuel out of the tank, we're going through a filter, and then it's going through your ECU, your computer control here, and they're running the fuel through the computer box to cool the computer box. So your ECU that's actually controlling the engine, so they're using it as a coolant mechanism for the computer that runs the engine. And so I'm putting other purposes other than just to run the engine.
And sometimes when they run the fuel through there, they've actually got a little light sensor. They can tell if it's green diesel or red diesel. If it's red, they can shut it off.
Where did you read that?
This is a book I was reading.
Jeez. Great. So I have never heard that. So some way of monitoring colored fuel. That'd be interesting. So this is added because we're pulling heat out of the system. Now we're going to actually add a fuel cooler into the system. So just like our radiators, we have some sort of little cooler system to kind of cool that fuel back down. As we go to high pressure common rail systems, because the fuel pressure is higher, anytime you build pressure, you create heat. And so we have new ways of cooling it and just new requirements, new added pieces to the system. So it just took our system and it's making it more complicated. It's kind of why I wanted to leave this one in there. This one here, they're showing that the fuel tank is just vented to the atmosphere. You won't find any modern gasoline cars going back a long ways that are just vented into the atmosphere, because we can't have evaporative emissions in a diesel. We have virtually no evaporative emissions. They can still vent these to the atmosphere. The tank itself, the tank pickup tends to be really close to the bottom. We want to draw that water off. We don't want to leave the water in the tank. In a gas engine, a lot of times they'll put the suction up off the bottom of the tank, let the water stay in there. We don't want to do that. We want to get the water out as quickly as possible, because that's going to lead to other issues. And so we want to suck that stuff off the bottom and get rid of it. The filters themselves then, because we don't want that water to go through the system, the filter now has to separate that water out. And since water doesn't separate very easily with diesel fuel, it takes some special filter requirements. So they have to be able to clean really good, because the fuel itself is lubricating and preventing any kind of metal contact from taking place. We want to make sure that there is no dirt in it, so the filtration parts per million has to be way smaller in a diesel fuel than it does in a gas engine. Dirt contamination is our main problem that we're going to have with a diesel fuel system, so we got to get the dirt out. We want virtually zero dirt. So if we can get it to zero, it would be great. It's pretty hard to get to zero, but we'll get it pretty close. And the elements, these new paper elements and stuff, have a coating on them, and that coating is a water coalescing coating, and then it just repels the water. So the material on the paper, special paper, separates the water, drops it into our water collection system that we can drain out. So if I was to use a fuel filter from a gas engine, put it on diesel, it's a filter, I'm just filling. It would do problems. The water would go through the paper and try to burn, and that's going to cause problems.
That would be common in this industry where we use those inline filters all the
time. So, and that's why I have some of them on the table there. So people are like, oh, I always use one of these. This one here, my diesel, my Volkswagen today, has this clear line. So you have your fuel lines comes from the tank and it goes to my filter. This is a clear line, and it allows you to see air bubbles. So if you had an air leak, a crack in the fuel line, and I'm pulling air bubbles, it'll actually show it there. You can see it. In old systems, we used to take a clear hose and stick it in there and actually look to see if I had air bubbles in the system. So that's part of our troubleshooting. Some of these modern ones, it's actually built into the system. The problem is most fuel line, the clear tubing that we would use, wasn't compatible with diesel fuel. So you could put it in there, do some troubleshooting for a week or so, but you couldn't leave it in there because it would deteriorate. So it's hard to find diesel fuel compatible clear fuel line. It's not very common. So it's hard to do. So this is kind of neat where the manufacturer said, well, let's build it into the system. And only the Germans would be smart enough to build it into the system. Everybody else does. So here's just an example of what's in the tank. A lot of times you have a float, some kind of fuel sending unit, they'll have electric fuel pump, and a fuel section with a screen. A lot of times this will be a pretty good filter here, just keeping out bugs. So lots of things sitting inside the fuel tank that may lead to future problems. So you notice that there's two lines here. One of them's going to be a suction, one's going to be a return. My car had some problems and I pulled my fuel tank, pulled the back seat off the fuel tank, and somebody had actually switched the two hoses. So they had, my car's damaged, and so when they rebuilt the car and they put the hoses back on, they swapped the inlet and the outlet. And there's a check valve in here that's supposed to keep it from siphoning backwards. And so why mine even worked, I have no idea. Because it had to pull the fuel past the check valve to get it up. So my car was starving for fuel for a long time. I probably put 10, 15,000 miles on before I actually found the problem. And it wasn't like a major problem, it just seemed like it was low powered all the time. So I forgot why I even was trying to solve the problem. So, but boy, it was a lot zippier once I switched the hoses and took it on the highway. I'm like, wow, this is amazing. So it makes a difference. So dirt abrasion, this is a super tight tolerance in your injection pump and in the injection nozzles. And so any kind of dirt is going to be, it's going to shorten the life of the fuel system. Hey, filter media, there's lots of different filter medias. Interesting one here is like cotton. So Caterpillar has a lot of filters. You pull them out and it's like, you know, it's a wire mesh with just cotton, the yarn, and they just wrap it and wrap it and wrap it and wrap it. And so in order for the fuel to get all the way through, it pretty much all debris gets caught up in it. So there's a lot of different mediums out there. Most of the time the old ones were just some sort of thick mediums that by the time they got through, it was clean. Today they're a little bit more creative. They've got better materials, and you'll see that glass and this glass fiber, they've come up with some stuff that's kind of unusual, but we've been able to manufacture stuff that's really good at cleaning. So it's microglass. Most systems are going to have a primary and a secondary filter. The primary filter goes down 10 to 50 microns. Secondary filters go down to 2 to 10 microns. So when we actually look at the inside of a fuel filter, here's an example of a fuel filter. Looking on the back, this is my inlet, this is my outlet, and then on the bottom here is the holes for the sensor. So if I get water in it, it gets up to the sensor, it sets the light off on my dash. And then this one down here is a water drain. So there'll be a spot you can open up and drain the water out. When I open up on the inside, there's two different sections. There's primary and secondary filtration system. And when you it goes on the 6.2 Chevy diesel, it's on my combine with a John Deere combine. So a lot of John Deeres have this filter. It's a very common older filter. It's either metal or you can get a glass one so you can actually look in it and see it. But it's got two different mediums in it. And the material you look at is thicker. These are just like an inline filter. So this is a single medium. This isn't a primary secondary. You might have this just to kind of screen the bugs out and the big stuff. This would be like a primary filter. If you have a diesel fuel system with one of these, you really should have another filter that's going to go finer. But the cheaper the engine, they may dispense with a secondary filtration system. So this is another canister style. This would be like the filter that would go inside of there. Fuel comes in, we're going to be able to separate some water. So it'll have some water coalescing features, but it's only got one filtration medium. There's not a primary, secondary. Very common on the equipment that we're working on to find this. If it has water in it, because typically we're using dyed fuel, if there's water in it, you'll notice that the bottom won't have a color. It'll be clear. And that's a sign that there's water in it. So I want to drain it out. Here's some more filters, single medium. So it goes in, it's going to filter it. The paper is a fairly thick, fine filtration, but again, it's only one medium that's on there so that it doesn't have multiple pieces in there. This filter here comes, there's a glass bowl on the bottom, so you can see the water will collect. There's a water collection system on it, but then there's just one. Sometimes you'll see this system with a primary filter and a secondary filter, or it may just have one. This particular filter will hand it around, and you'll see on the top, there's actually some stuff on the top, which my students have kind of keep wiping it away. But it kind of looks like sand. So I took this one off. This whole thing was just covered. There's like a big pile of that white stuff. And it looked like white sand from an ocean beach. And I thought, how did white sand get into my tractor, which is not anywhere near a beach, and we really don't have sand around here. And what happened is I took my tractor here to the college, and it was back when I was in the same building as the diesel program, and there was one of these sadistic diesel students, and they had a coffee pot, and next to the coffee pot was a box of sugar cubes. And so I don't know, for some reason he decided to put them in my fuel tank. And so he dumped the box of cube sugar cubes in my tractor. And I took my tractor back home, so we serviced it or did something to it. Took it back home, when I hooked it to a sprayer, I'm driving along, all of a sudden it just started getting hot, and it started slowing down, and I guess like my fuel filter was plugged, so I pulled my filter off, and that's what I found. Normally, if you put sugar in somebody's diesel tank, it will seize the engine, and it will wipe out their engine pretty quick. And so in my case, it didn't actually seize my engine because he used sugar cubes. You take a hot cup of coffee and drop a sugar cube in it, what's it do? It falls down and it sits there. It doesn't actually dissolve. If you don't stir it, a sugar cube doesn't dissolve. And so if he used, you know, loose sugar, it probably would have dissolved pretty readily, but because he used the sugar cubes, it went and it actually just stayed as a crystal. And it plugged the filter before it damaged the engine. So I got really lucky. It was really bizarre.
That's what they used to do back in World War II. If they wanted to find a car, they just put some sugar in the gas tank and it would stop all the army cars. These guys, they were.
Yep. So this is an electric fuel pump, and in the end of the electric fuel pump is a filter. And so this one, you can find these on Toyotas with gas engines, and you can find them on Toro. Most Toro products have an electric fuel pump, and theirs has a paper. So you can take this filter out, and they have a paper filter. So the primary filtration before it gets into the fuel pump, they have a paper one. And then afterwards, there'll be a spin-on one that's the secondary finer filtration. And people keep changing that one because it's open and you can see it. This is buried up in the firewall. And they're like, well, that's the fuel pump, so that's not where it's at. It doesn't have a primary filter. Well, it does. And they just don't ever change it because they never read the operator's manual. And you open it up and it's just packed full of crap.
That fails first.
Well, you're starving for fuel and they can't figure out why. They think, well, maybe it's plugged on the hose on the end or something. They troubleshoot all these different problems. And if you look at your parts page or you just read your operator's manual, it tells you, change this filter. And so the same pump, it's just different kinds of filters that are on there. So there's lots of different kinds of filters. Lots of different kinds of filters. Whatever you do, don't put the wrong filter. So my brother has a couple of Caterpillar products. His semi has a cat engine in it. He got a telehandler that's a cat. And there are stories out there of people that are not Caterpillar people, but they've noticed that using the Caterpillar filter have less problems than if they use aftermarket filters. Either they don't filter them enough and they have a lot more failures. And so he's kind of gone in his Caterpillar products of buying the OEM filter, knowing that the OEM filter is going to do the job. And in that particular case, the filters don't cost much different between OEM and not OEM. Why not buy the OEM we know is making a product to make their product last? So a lot of times with these newer products, it really is in your best interest, pay a little bit more and get the right filter rather than some kind of aftermarket one. So be careful with it. When you replace the fuel filter, you want to make sure that you put it in dry and then pump the fuel through it. If you put the filter in or go pour fuel in it, fill it up and then stick it in, the fuel that you pour in there is not going through the filter and it's not filtering. So especially if you pour it into the middle, because fuel goes from the outside in. So if you pour it in the inside and fill your filter up, you're pouring dirty fuel in the middle, and the first thing that goes into your engine is the bad fuel. So if you're going to do that, you'd want to pour it only in the outside to get it to go in and let it bleed or wick its way to the inside. You can do that. But for the most part, it's easier to put it on dry, pump the fluid through. And most fuel systems have either a hand pump, a push valve, or electric fuel pump like you see there. They'll have something that allows it to bleed the system because I don't want air in the system. And somewhere there may be one or more bleed screws that allow you to bleed the air out of the system. And you want to make sure that you bleed it out. If you don't try to start the system, I'm changing my fuel filters, I take my filter off, I dispose of the fuel, I put a new filter on, if you open the bleed screw and do whatever mechanism there is and you bleed that filter out, you should be able to close it down and start it right up. If you put the filter on, you don't bleed the air out correctly, you open the wrong purge screw, sometimes there'll be multiple screws, one of them will be lower than the other, and air always wants to rise, so make sure you get the right one. If you don't, and then you try to start it, that air goes into the system, and it could cause blockage, and it could cause problems. So make sure that you don't try to start it, make sure you're certain you've read the operator's manual on how to bleed it, follow the instructions, and then it should start right back up. There's a lot of different kinds of filters. This is that micro glass medium. Most fuel filters have some sort of water drain. So unlike a gas engine, most diesel fuel systems have some way of draining the water out because the medium is separating the water so it doesn't go through the rest of the system. Gas engines kind of absorb it and send it through. We don't. We want to separate it and we want to drain it. And a lot of them will have some sort of warning system on there that says, hey, you're getting a lot of water, make sure you drain it. Filters, diesel fuel is gonna go real fine, so it's gonna make smaller dirt particles before it goes through. This particular fuel filter has a two-part system, so primary and a secondary, so in the same canister, just like that metal one, it's gonna be two parts, trying to get that water out and try to filter it down finer. Fuel systems for our diesel, this is way more complicated than in a gas engine, just because it has a higher filtration requirement. So you have primary and secondaries, you may have a water fuel separator sensor, some kind of sensor down here, some sort of water drain cup, and then there actually may be some kind of fuel heater. And the fuel heater we'll talk about a little bit more, but that's to keep it from gelling up. So we want to heat the fuel up so it doesn't solidify in there and get stuck in the system. So they're a lot more complicated. There's a lot more to a fuel system than we normally think. This here is an example of a hand primer. So this is just a bulb that sits on top. You just push on it, boom, 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 and it pumps the fuel through the system. That's a mechanical fuel system. Fuel conditioning, so what are we trying to filter out? Different things I'm trying to do. One of them is asphaltines, some weird name like that. So these are like little black balls, and it's just kind of stuff that floats in the system. And this particular container here, I don't know where this came from, but it has lots of black material in there that's floating around, and so it just kind of plugs up your fuel filter.
What
so
is it, it's, or is it like little rubber chunks or fuel lines or dirt?
Or? It's kind of a fuel algae type material, so really it's probably just organic material. And they don't really name in your book that this is part of the bacteria or the fuel algae. It's just kind of stuff that floats. So I think it's just organic material that's kind of in the system and kind of clings together and plugs up your fuel system. So there's just that. That's going to plug up my fuel system. And because our fuel systems are so fine, you know, really fine stuff's going to plug it up. The next one, which is the most destructive, is water. Water is extremely bad in a diesel fuel system because water has no lubrication value at all. And my full fuel system is all lubricated with the fuel itself. If I get water in the system, it's going to cause, I could seize up or damage my fuel injection pump. My injectors themselves could get damaged from actually seizing in there. And when the fuel, or the air, water, when the water hits the tip of the injector, because the tip of the injector is very hot, it actually turns into a steam. And when the steam exits that injector, it can actually blow the tip off of the injector. So water is destructive in a lot of ways. If you're running it through the system and you shut the system down, let it sit for a while, it's going to rust. So you have rusting of the system and it's going to cause some corrosion in there. So water is something we don't want in there at all. If it's in the tank, if we let the water sit in the tank, if it's a metal tank, it's going to rust the tank. If it's not a rubber tank, or if it's a plastic tank, then the water sits on the bottom and is actually going to promote fuel algae. And we have an example of what fuel algae is. Fuel algae is a microscopic bug that lives in the water and it actually eats the diesel fuel. And so this container here, we took this out of a tank that is a fairway mower that came from the west side. So lots of rain over there, they had lots of water, they didn't drain it. We had a problem with it, kept running out of fuel. We pulled the hose out of the tank, and on the end of the hose was a screen, just a mesh, like a screen door screen, and it was just a ball of trash. And that trash was fuel algae, so just the trash on there. And this is what we drew out of there. And this was actually red, and then you can see. So don't shake this, but on the bottom you can see it's just algae floating along in there. And slowly over time, our fuel water on the bottom is actually kind of growing, so it's actually more than it was before. So it grows on it, and it kind of leaves a byproduct more water.
Does it eat through trash?
Doesn't eat through the water, it just eats on the fuel, creates that material that you see, and that material plugs the fuel system.
Because the hybrid Toyotas have a rubber bladder in their fuel tanks, and that's what...
No. No, I'm not aware that they're used to rubber. This stuff just eats the fuel system and the byproduct plugs the system. That's why it's so bad. So the only way you can get rid of it is use some sort of biocide. You have to have something that will actually kill it. So it's like a fungicide that you put in there and it will kill it. The biggest problem is you get that in your storage tank, and then every machine that you put fuel into, it transfers into it and you contaminate all of your fleet. And so that's the big problem, is storage tanks sit there and they don't move, it doesn't shake, it doesn't get mixed in, doesn't get sucked up. That water settles on the bottom. Most fuel storage tanks, you notice, they need to be at an angle, tipped back, and you need to drain them and keep them drained. You let water pool in there, it promotes that. The new fuels that are out here, this low sulfur fuels, one way to meet the emission standards and to deal with it, one of the ingredients that they took out was biocide. Fuels had their list of additives. One of the additives was a biocide to prevent that from happening, but to meet emissions, they eliminated the biocide in the low ultra sulfur fuel. And so now if I have water in the system and I have fuel algae, there's nothing in the fuel to kill it. And so it's becoming worse. And what is the second thing that we put into fuel today that likes water?
Biodiesel.
Biodiesel loves water and absorbs water. So we're moving more to biofuels. So in the state of Washington and Oregon, it's supposed to be 4 or 5%. The last couple of years, they've had stuff as high as 20%. And so we get this ultra high volume of biodiesel. And then we don't have any biocide in there, and so these people are using this fuel. It sits in a combine, their trucks, their big tractors, sits all winter. They've got biodiesel in there, they got water in the bottom of the tank, and this fuel algae is becoming a serious problem in the Northwest. So my guy, fuel guy, oil guy, came and he's like, you know, I'm not going to tell you, but I would buy this. And so I bought a bottle of biocide, and before winter started, I just went out and put a little bit in all of my stuff that was just going to sit all winter. So if I had anything in there, it would kind of protect myself over the winter. So it's a problem. Lots of problems out there.
Do you know if any of the fuel stations put any kind of biocide in their tanks?
Fuel stations, as far as I know, no fuel station is going to add it, anything extra. So, and it's not coming from the fuel distributors, because when they add it, it messes with the emissions. And so not to mess with emissions, they probably cannot by law put it in there. So it's not in there. So I haven't talked to my guy for like the last 2 years really about this subject. So I don't know what it's like today, but I don't know. So it's just ongoing problems. Here's an example. This is like that white filter. This is what's on the bottom of that filter. Usually it's a clear, so I can see if there's water in there or other trash in there. You want to be able to visibly inspect it. Be careful about how you store fuels. Don't store fuels in a 55-gallon barrel that's sitting out in the weather, especially level, because water puddles, and then when it cools off, it sucks it in. So it'll take a 55-gallon barrel. When you heat it up and you seal it off, it's a lot of suction. I have a 55-gallon barrel sitting in my yard right now that it was hot, really hot out, and I put the lids on and tightened them down because I didn't want moisture to get in. And then this winter when it got cold, it actually sucked the walls in on the 55-gallon barrel, so it's actually three-sided, so it's got three flat sides. It sucked it in. I'm like, so it's amazing how much contraction, expansion, contraction there is. I have a barrel there right now that I have the lid pretty well sealed on, and in the evening, when the sun goes down, it pops every night. In the morning, it pops again because it's expanding, contracting. But I have it sealed because I don't want it to be pulling air in and then condensing and then pushing air out. So it's amazing. Don't store stuff in the weather. So any kind of storage, above ground storage, you don't want above ground storage is sitting up there. You want to have it covered. There's things you can do to prevent this from happening. Putting a pressure vacuum gauge or a valve on there to help keep it from drawing as much air and fuel air in there, and moisture is a good thing. And making sure you're keeping water off of it is a good thing. The best thing to do is keep it at a consistent temperature, keep it out of the sun. That's what's best. Which the easiest way to do that is to bury it in the ground. And when you bury it in the ground and it has a leak, then you dig forever before you get to the bottom of it. It's very expensive. So in the old days, that's what we did. We buried it to keep it consistent. But it's a whole other set of problems. So now you see most are above ground storages, but they're multiple layers so that they have some kind of insulation. So there's usually a tank with another tank on the outside. A lot of times there'll be a concrete so someone can't drive by and shoot your tank and blow it up. So there's actually a layer of concrete in there. And then the inner outer layers have a sensor. If some liquid starts showing up, an alarm goes off and says, hey, you have a leaky of your primary tank. So the tanks have become kind of complicated. But that gives it some kind of heating, cooling protection. Fuel water separators. The fuel heaters, we've seen a picture, had the heater in there. That prevents the gelling that takes place. If we can keep that wax crystals from gelling up, then it will actually keep flowing. We can get the temperature warm as the engine warms up. It'll actually heat the tank up. So we use fuel heaters when it's cold. The water separators, you think, okay, we're separating the water. It's got this bowl, it's all full of water. You got a tank with water in it. In the winter time, that water is going to freeze. So in the fall, going around and kind of draining out of your tanks and your fuel separators might prevent that thing from cracking. So be careful about that. Some machines have these sensors in them, and a light will come on in your dash, says, hey, it's getting pretty full, make sure you drain it. This is in the bottom of a diesel, power stroke diesel, and they have a fuel heater in the bottom. This one here has a fuel heater, it's bolted onto the side, so just becoming complicated. Here's my primary filters, my fuel transfer pump, here's my secondary filter, then it goes up to my injection pump, drops back in, so that's just pumps. So we go from something pretty simple to something a lot more complex. So here we have filter, we have fuel coolers, high pressure injection pump, where we say high pressure, we're talking 35,000, 40,000 PSI, very high pressure, common rail diesel fuel systems. That is what we will be dealing with today. Almost virtually everything now is common rail, super high injection pressures. This is just, I left this one in here because you can see all the complication. We got two turbos in here, we have oil filter, we have a fuel filter, we have a fuel cooler, we have a coolant tank for our antifreeze, and we have a surge tank for our antifreeze. We have two things here. So we're just adding and adding and adding. You pull the hood, you're like, oh my gosh, I just want to walk away. Hand primers, different pumps. We have hand primers or primer buttons, so you see like a little lever that you pull. There could be a button that you push in and out. Some of them actually have a thing where you actually turn a knob, it pulls it out, and it's actually a plunger, so you pull the plunger up and down. Some of them are like what you've seen earlier, which is right on top of the filter, and it's just a push button. Somewhere, there has to be a way to purge the air out. If it does not have an electric fuel pump, somewhere there's going to be a hand system that you've got to find to make it work. So you need to look for it. So the electric ones are nice. You just turn the key on and it pressurizes the system. You open the bleed screws until it quits bubbling and foaming and tighten it back down. Done. So the hand primer ones can take a little more work. So gasoline, if you have gasoline contamination in your fuel system, you just want to get it out. Yes, you can burn a little bit of gasoline in a diesel system, but if it's summertime and I'm doing that, you're going to see some damage take place. If it's in the winter, because sometimes people will add gasoline to their diesel to help make it more volatile so that it burns. And we're talking, you know, Montana, North Dakota, where it's like, you know, 16 below zero, crazy places where it's crazy cold. But you need to understand what you're doing when you start doing this adding of gasoline. So if you put gas in diesel, you want to drain as much as you can. Drain all the filters and dump them and replace them. Just get as much out as you can. Don't worry about, you know, blowing every line out. But you want to drain as much as you can, flush it through, and then run it. A little bit of gasoline will go through. But if you get very much at all, you're going to have big problems. Things are going to start seizing up because it has no lubrication value. So don't do it as a matter of practice. Electric fuel pumps, this is how electric fuel pump works. Here the solenoid is on. When the electric magnet becomes magnetized, there's a metal plunger. The plunger is centered. It pulls it into the center of the magnet. When it pulls it, it's going to push. It's going to actually pull some fuel into this cavity. So you have a check valve and a check valve. So when I move back, this is going to fill up with fuel. When it gets back here, it shuts the magnet off. The metal plunger's got a spring and it pushes the plunger in. Since we have a check valve, it seals. This unseats itself and pushes the fuel out. So that chattering that you hear, it's a solenoid that's pulling the plunger back, and then going back is it's hitting the end of the housing. So it pulls it, releases, pulls it, releases. So it's electrically turning it on and off, on and off. So that's the little clicking, pulsing that you see. And there's just two check valves in there. This metal plunger, because it's a metal plunger that's physically moving in the bore, it's a nice simple system, but what happens when I have metal to metal rubbing against each other? It's going to wear. If you don't have a primary filter taking material out, the dirt out, this metal to metal can wear pretty fast. So you definitely would want to have a primary filter beforehand. And remember, the primary filter is not going to take everything out. This thing eventually is going to wear. Where does the metal go that wears? Down the pipe. If you don't have a secondary filter that's really fine afterwards, and this goes from this fuel pump into your injection pump, I'm spitting that metal into my fuel injection pump. If it did happen to make it through that, it's going to end up in your injectors. So you want to make sure that this thing has filtration afterwards. Dodge and Ford both on their pickups, if you have a system where the fuel pump that's in the tank starts to get really weak, there's another filter, another pump that's up on the front, your fuel injection pump, one of them. If the system starts to get weak and it's not pumping enough fuel, then it starts to get air in the system, and that metal from the filter or the pump that's in the back spits into your main fuel injection pump. Or this pump, because it's not, if the screen gets plugged, this thing is moving back and forth. It's not pumping any fuel. The lubrication's missing because I'm not pumping any fuel. The metal from this pump spits out and it takes out the whole system. It takes out your main fuel injection pump. As the fuel injection pump fails, what kind of filtration comes after the fuel injection pump?
The injector nozzle tips.
the injection nozzle tips. So only stuff big enough to plug it up is going to do it. And so if the main injection pump goes bad, you always need to replace or repair the injectors themselves. So there was a lot of problems with the fuel pressure going low on Power Strokes and Cummins and that kind of stuff. So if you get onto those blogs that they have fuel injection gauges that you can put in your pickup, and those gauges kind of tell you, do I have a failure of my lift pump? And so lift pumps are going bad on a lot of those. It's a common problem. And as they got weak, they actually would take out the fuel injection pump and the nozzles or the injectors themselves, because the metal from this thing would get into the system and wipe out the other parts of the system. And so the fuel pressure regulator tester or the fuel gauges actually were a way to know, is my pump getting weak or not? So there are different points in the system that we can measure that pressure and know if we have a problem. I might have a gauge after the filter that says, hey, the filter is bad and it's restricting it. I'm not getting fuel to my transfer pump, or I'm not getting fuel through my secondary filter, or I'm not getting it up to my high pressure fuel system. So there are systems out there that are so expensive, they weren't having gauges installed in the system. This is a troubleshooting thing, so you can plumb gauges in at different points to be trying to figure out where the problem is. So, and on my pickup, I have a Power Stroke and I don't really notice it so much. My brother-in-law has got Dodges, and man, that was running rampant through some of the Dodge systems where these pressure drops were taking out the system. So it's a common problem out there. So inspection points is just kind of a chart that kind of shows different inspection points, kind of what pressures you might expect at different points in my system. And so you kind of just need to know the system. And every system's going to be a little bit different. Know your system and then know what to expect when you get into the system. That is chapter 7.